Bien, comenzamos. Good morning. I am happy to be able to moderate this session, where works from Philippines, Canada, and Peru are present. I will introduce each speaker as they participate. First, I introduce to Rick Daniel Etil. I don't know if my pronunciation is good. He works at his Etil or Rick Daniel work as Christian it's a 20 years old teacher who is teaching Christian living and values education in Binangonan Catholic College, Philippines. He earned his bachelor's degree in philosophy at the Immaculate Conception Mayor Seminary in Philippines. He's currently studying at the University of San Tomas Graduate School for his master's degree in philosophy. Rick, can you, his work is an analysis of Stein's phenomenology of empathy in the light of Filipino community pantries. Okay, Rick, Daniel, can you speak?
Okay, so good day, everyone. So good morning there, and good evening here in the Philippines. So can I present now my presentation?
Yes.
Thank you. So give me a minute. So my paper presentation is about an analysis of Stein's phenomenology of empathy in the light of Filipino community pantries. So my paper is an attempt to correlate Stein's notion of empathy in the phenomenological experience of the Filipino, specifically the community pantries. It becomes phenomenal, and at the same time, I will try to present the impact of Stein's notion of empathy in the light of Filipino community pantries. So my main problem or my main question regarding my paper is, how can empathy affect the I and the other in the community pantry? Since in the community pantry, we talk about the connection between the I and the other, because there will be, we cannot say a community as a community if there is no I in the other. So the outline of my presentation will be, first, the phenomenology of community pantry, wherein I will discuss how this community pantry begins in the Philippines. And next, an overview of Stein's notion of empathy. Since I think all of us here are familiar with Stein's notion of empathy, so I will just give a gist, an overview of it. And then how this empathy correlates to the I towards the community pantry. So how will the I react or respond, no, to the community pantry? And then next is the I and the other in the community pantry. So with the relationship between the I and the other, on how they empathize, on how this how empathy occurs in the context of community pantry. And then community pantry as an empathic and societal act, wherein I will show later that community pantry is an empathic act, and at the same time, a societal act wherein it helps the society, or in a way, it shapes the society by helping one another, by being charitable with one another. And then the last one is the conclusion. So let me begin on the first part of my presentation regarding the phenomenology of community pantry. So I try to summarize my paper presentation since it is a lengthy one. So I will just give some, I will just present the salient points of each topic that I will present. So the trademark of this community pantry, give what you can, take what you need. So this becomes the, this phrase, no, becomes a trend in the Philippines wherein it influences other people for some organizations to do the same, to establish a community pantry. So the first community pantry happened on last April 14, 2021. And it was initiated by Anna Patricia Non. So a woman belongs no, in Quezon, who lives in Quezon City. So Quezon City is a part, it's a place here in the Philippines.
Por ejemplo, te tomas un tecito de hoja de coca y eso, ¡uy!, resucitas con esa hojita, ¿no? Entonces, ¿qué hacía el Chasqui? En su estocita tenía ahí hojitas de coca, ¿no? Y cuando había, hacía mucho frío o necesitaba más energía, ¿qué hacía? Sacaba sus hojitas y comenzaba a masticar. Ñam, 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 ñam. El juguito se lo pasaba. En provincia dicen chachar la coca. Entonces chachar la coca es masticar la coca en la boquita, ¿no? Ñam, 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 ñam. Masticas y vas pasándolo el juguito. Y eso te ayuda cuando hace frío porque te da calorcito. Y cuando estás muy cansado te da energía la hojita de coca. Por eso hay un bol de coca, ¿sí o no? Aunque no tiene mucho. Ahí está. Estas son las hojitas de coca. Miren, estas son las hojitas. Ya está un poquito seco. Tiene que estar más verdecito.
Anyone,
estas son las hojitas participants. De coca. Y acá ha hecho un tecito de hojita de coca para el frío o cuando te sientes mal, ¿no? Y te tomas este tecito y ¡aso! Resucitaste. Nuevamente. Eso es muy buena. Claro, hija, hay muchas hojitas de coca. En ese tiempo, chicos, esto, la coca servía para eso. Ahora la coca se utiliza para algunas cosas malas, ¿no? Algunas. Dime, Patrick, tu mano está
bien. Mire, pero con la coca también, con la coca también se hace medicina.
David, whose microphone is open right now, so can anyone please turn off this microphone?
You can do that. Excuse me, but José Miguel.
Vale. No. Yeah, Alarcón.
Oye, Karim, no me partí, no Karim.
No puedo descansar, no se puede despertar toda la noche, mañana ya no puedo correr.
Quedó ahorita. Ya, yo qué soy, adivino con una patadita.
La vida.
Ya hemos dicho que son niños obedientes, no son niños en su malcriado que, ay, no quiero, pero hoy día no me gusta correr, hace mucho frío.
Está interrumpiendo.
Sí, I think it's already done, so let me continue. Sorry for the interruption.
Thank you.
So to continue, so the community pantry becomes phenomenal. So the initiative of Ann Patricia Non inspires other people to make their own pantries. However, there are some government officials or citizens who disagree with this kind of empathic act, wherein it becomes somehow a threat. And there is an issue wherein Ann Patricia Non, the one who initiated the community pantry, is being red tagged. However, it does not hinder her to continue the advocacy. And that is why it becomes a phenomenal one, because people are trying their best, are doing their best to help one another in the midst of pandemic. So, next, let me now proceed on an overview of Stein's notion of empathy. So, Stein's notion of empathy, it focuses on the structure of experience. It is more than putting oneself into the shoes of another. It is being aware of the experience of other subjects wherein we can also relate. And also in Stein's dissertation on the problem of empathy, he discussed the three stages wherein there is an emergence of the experience, the fulfilling explication, and the comprehensive objectification of the extended experience. So this is where we, by entering or by being aware of the experience of the other, no, it is a kind of perceiving. It is somehow relating our experience to the experience of the other that we encounter or that we face that moment. And next, so the eye towards the community pantry. So as the world presents itself in different strands of phenomena, so the consciousness of the eye perceives it. So let me begin with a question. What is the intention of establishing a community pantry? So what is the intention of the subject of the eye in establishing the community pantry? So one can have presuppositions of it, whether positively or negatively. One can say that the intention of having a community pantry is to become famous. Or another will say that his intention is to help the people who are in need. And based on the interview of Non, so she said that there are people who experience hunger. And that is by being aware of that hungerness, no, the experience of hunger, her response is that she established a community pantry. And she encouraged people not to do the same. And she described the consumption of goods as a good problem because the goal is to give these goods to the needy. And we can see that this is kind of empathy, wherein in the experience of Non, she was aware of the experience of hunger. And this experience of hunger, poverty, struggles, gears her to establish a community pantry. The various experiences of the eye result in the desire to participate in helping others. By being a part of the phenomena, by seeing what it is, by facing the reality, so the eye the eye participates by helping others. And the rise of the community pantries is presupposed to the idea of one's experience. And one act to describe is the desire to participate for others. This is how empathy influences the eye. It touches one's soul to bring in fullness into reality, this empathic act. Next is the I and the other in the community pantry. So now we will talk about the relationship of the I and the other in the community pantry. So as the I, the subject of giving rise to community pantries, shows her empathic act, it also influences the other. The other, the one who receives the good, and witnessing this movement affects their interiority. The other can be seen as another I who is capable of giving and helping others. So in the experience of establishing these community pantries, the one who established can also influence the other, the one who receives, can also be the one who will give in the future. Because of the experience of the other being taken care of, being helped. So this is in a way, this is just a possibility that the other can also be capable of giving and helping others. Because understanding the empathy of Stein does not mean to dictate the action of the others. Rather, doing an empathic act is an openness of the eye towards the other. And then the relationship between the eye and the other can also be positive or negative. And to give an example, people lining up to get their goods can think that others are in need aside from themselves. Also, people clamoring to the goods they receive or consuming almost everything beyond their needs. So there are instances in the community pantry. Nonetheless, whether it connotes positivity or negativity, there is an experience primordially at that moment. It is important to consider that emotions are the effects upon this encounter, wherein the one who gives may experience joy in giving, and the one who receives may experience gratitude and hope. There is a possibility that the receiver may be a giver. Likewise, the giver may become the receiver. The relationship of the I and the other presents facets of emotions that flows on that given moment. And with this, the community pantry, an empathic and societal act. Community pantry may not happen without the relationship of the I and the other. It is an empathic act because of their experience. The experience of sharing something as a means of hope for others who have nothing. And to live in the experience of those who have nothing is to give something for them. With that similar experience, one will become aware of what he can do to help others. And through empathy in the guise of community pantry, it affects every individual and influences other communities to do the same, to spread this act of charity. And empathy gears the individual to participate in the community. And at the same time, the community affects the individual. Even with our uniqueness, one can have a common experience in which the collective individual contributes it for the good of community. And through empathy, one can attain sociality in the community. And to conclude my presentation, community pantry cannot happen if there is no introspection of the ego and transcending oneself to the pandemic by doing something for the community. The role of empathy in this phenomenon is to teach every individual to care for others, an act of charity. Empathy pertains to the structure of experience. And by immersing oneself in the other's experience, we can understand better, if not entirely, situation of the other. And in such a way, we can also do something, no, for the other. The rise of community pantries emerges from the experiences of every individual. The non-primordial experience of loss, of hunger, suffering, and others related experiences of it. Stein's empathy teaches us that our experience and foreign experiences lead to the value of oneself and others. With that is the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Rick. And I don't know if anyone has any questions. I don't see in the chat. No? I'm going to make one to Rick. Rick, you know, I think that it's very important to introduce in your work the notion of community in Edith Stein. It's very strong, and I think that this notion goes to make your presentation and your work more strong. I don't know if you learn in the second part of psychology, and you read this text of Edith Stein.
I actually read the Philosophy of Psychology and Humanities, yes. And that is also one of the reasons why that is one of the reasons to support my claim regarding the
empathy. Okay.
And another thing, I'm planning, as much as I want to give much more emphasis on the community. However, yep. Due to the lack of resources, since I do not have yet the one of the writings of Edith Stein on community.
Okay.
So that is why, due to the limited sources, I cannot fully expound more. I know, and
okay.
Even though I am aware that this book of Stein is very helpful in enriching my presentation.
Okay, thank you. Sarah Borden has a question. I don't know if Sarah wants to speak. Yeah, excuse me, Sarah.
Or,
yes, Sarah.
I like your argument that empathy has to be foundational for any move to the kind of project of a food pantry. I wondered if you thought there were sort of further moves that also needed to be made, even if it's foundational, would there be kind of layered further acts and further elements that would need to be present? And how would you describe those?
Okay, thank you. Dr. Sarah Burden, Charity, and before I answer your question, I would like to thank you first, no, for giving this opportunity to participate in this conference, and thank you also for helping me in my research on Edith Stein.
It's wonderful to hear your paper and great to see you here.
Yes.
I'm very happy.
And I was, and I'm thankful that you are here listening to my presentation. So with going back to your question, Dr. Sarah, so do you see empathy as the foundation of the move to food pantries, but not sufficient for the full move to it? If so, what will have to build on empathy? So I, based on my understanding of Edith Stein's notion of empathy, I think there must be layers for empathy to happen. And I think one of its layers is first the experience, because we cannot somehow make a move if we do not experience it yet. These experiences will help us to do something or to make an empathic act. But it depends on the eye or the subject, since there will be instances wherein he or she can be hesitant, especially if that person is anxious in his actions and can be an obstacle to empathize. And possible it will fall to sympathy. I think I answer your question, Dr. Sara.
Yeah, that's exactly. I was wondering where sympathy would have to fit and how to cultivate that as well as empathy.
Any question, Adriana? I don't know. No. Yeah, okay. Okay. Thank you very much, Rip. So, I think that this is an important work, because the practice and the life, the living is very important to the make community and live the empathy with others. Thank you very much. And then I introduce to Eugene. Excuse me, because my Eugene. He is literary translator and a great upstage PhD candidate in English literature at Kingston University, London. His interest lies in the topic of empathy and a mode of one's indirect experience on other beings. His doctoral project, entitled Gothic Empathy, explores how negative aesthetic in modern Europe and Britain has liberated the sense of self and other from the 18th century myth of sympathy. His interest in how vicarious feeling particularly creates through a reading experience of Gothic novel, deconstruct hierarchy, between the author and the reader. Eugene, you are, can you, I don't see you.
Oh, I think I turned on my camera. Do you not see me?
Okay.
I'm here.
Excuse me, I think that you are a
man.
Excuse me.
My name, yes, okay. Yes. But in my country, you use a female name.
Yes.
That's okay, yes, no worries.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
I don't see you.
Yes, I'm here, yes.
You are so, fans of all that I say in she.
Oh, yes, thank you. Okay, hi everyone. So today I'd like to discuss Edith Stein's concept of empathy in the context of the Gothic. And I know the Gothic is a very, unusual subject that the people takes in Edith Stein's study, I think. And also by the term Gothic, I mean a form of art, specifically Gothic literature, which allows us to consider the significance of the other being and my experience of that other being, usually that is beyond the boundaries of self. And in my doctoral thesis, I'm discussing a woman writer, Anne Radcliffe, who who earned a lot of fame and money with their best-selling Gothic novel, The Mysteries of Udolpho, in the 18th century Britain. And obviously, at a glance, it seems so irrelevant to find anything in common between Radcliffe and Stein. There is almost a century of time gap, and also there is also this field gap they served, and Radcliffe in popular fiction, and it is Stein in philosophy. Nevertheless, I've been plowing through for years to conclude my thesis that argues that there is a distinctive tradition of empathy in the history, and in that tradition of model definition, because empathy is often confused with sympathy, I am focusing on a kind of negative, self-generating, and almost visceral aspect in empathy that can be found in the language of Stein and Radcliffe. I believe that we cannot fully describe empathy without the body and the spirit, and both Stein and Radcliffe share the same idea about empathy as a process of experiencing other beings. In other words, the way they understood the humanity is very similar to each other, and later on, a modernist writer, Virginia Woolf, continues the tradition as I'm planning to argue my thesis. And I know my approach is unusual, like the established notion of empathy in literary scholarship, which tends to defend altruism, but I believe what I try to articulate by Gothic empathy bears significance as well. It is essential to go through some process that entails negative feelings to empathize with something or someone that is not me. And there is a nuance of empathy that has been neglected for long, and it is time we turn to Edith Stein to correctly describe the nuance. So the time when Edith Stein lived witnessed the boom in empathy study in psychology. For Theodore Lips, for example, the key to understanding empathy is that one feels oneness in the wake of the inner excitement, as he says, as well as inner movement with the form of the object we empathize with. Here, I'd like to stress Lips' frequent address of inner activity that we are moved by the object to feel the object. It implies that he finds a formal and subtle aspect of empathy that occurs around soft boundaries of self that does not pertain to knowledge. Lips' highlight of fusion explains why he was interested in the mysterious working of the multiple senses when coordinating to exercise empathy towards an object. So he says, quote, if a sensation A has come together with a sensation B, has entered into a sufficiently close relation with it, then every later it may reproduce, A may reproduce the B and hence appear connected with A, he says. Unquote. Empathy impacts on my meaning making of the object, and on this occasion, the meaning does not hold any objectivity as it is, and not fixated by any normative values like his example of optical illusion. Following his interesting claim, responses were made in several disciplines, and Stein was one of them. In her doctoral thesis, titled On the Problem of Empathy, Stein agrees with Lips' notion of immediacy that empathy directly takes place in one's internal experience when one relates to other beings. So for Stein, Lips' account about how empathy operates, anticipating conscious perception, makes sense. In order for one to understand another being's lived experience, he or she starts by relating to others directly and immediately. However, what she's not happy with Lips' theory is about the content of empathy, that the empathizer feels oneness with the object of empathy. She argues that there is no such thing as complete empathy. That was a quote from the Stein's book, because for her, empathy should be a naturally ego-foreign experience. And this discrepancy between the body and that feels a certain movement that the consciousness that strives to understand other being is what I'm curious about Stein's claim on empathy. She admits that the distinction between I and other being is virtually obliterated. And this is where she agrees with Lips' example of the spectator's empathy when we watch an acrobat on the rope. So we feel him, that's evident, but she makes clear that such a bodily representation on the empathizer's side, despite him or her being directly affected, does not alone complete the sense of real I through what Lipps terms unipathy, a feeling of oneness, because after all, our empathy constructs our own emotion and our own knowledge, not the person we feel for. It generates from the side of the empathizer, and, quote, a distinction only arises when I step out of complete empathy and reflection on my real life, unquote. Stein extends Lipps's claim and includes a signaling point and distinction after the sensual fusion with the other being. So the I after empathy is not the same I before the empathy. And to me, this transition process holds a strong affinity with the way the Gothic writer Radcliffe characterizes our protagonist, Emily Saint-Aubert, using the Gothic trope. When Stein argues the empathy causes distinction between I and others eventually, the term distinction implies that empathy enables distinctive individuals in the society who share some psychophysical space that cannot be accessed wholly by either individual, but that realm allows them to exist, connected, and all different from one another. Stein's use of terms needs a thorough understanding. For example, for Stein, empathy is not about us as a result, but the very approximation of mingling. It does not have a solid content as a combination of two people's feeling, because for Stein, it is impossible for one to know others' feeling as it is. Rather, empathy calls for numerous encounters with other individuals that I can associate with time to time. Therefore, we can even say that the world is comprised of different eyes in the world. However, one should note on this account, Stein's empathic eye has two premises that can be easily mistaken. First, she postulates that there is no way that I can transcend the extent of my experience and feel, thus know, exactly what others feel and think. Second, this empathic eye always desires to be affected, open to otherness. In order to explicate the seemingly conflicting two premises, during the early period in her academic life, Stein holds a phenomenological point of view. It is important to know that during the early period in her academic life, Stein holds a phenomenological point of view. For instance, she argues that what Lipps is describing is a psychic contagion, not empathy, focalizing whole purpose of our theory at answering what is human nature, or in her term, personality. Stein's inquiry moves forward to the pursuit of the truth of humanity. Two central questions guiding empathy research from her time still stand strong up to present day, namely, how can one know what other person is thinking and feeling, as well as what leads one person to respond with sensitivity and care to the suffering of others. Ultimately, Stein's theory acknowledges the possibility that we can still feel for others, even if it is limited to my experience. It nevertheless expands my boundaries, regardless of the content of the feeling as a representation of empathy. In order to illustrate this point, Stein suggests that there are three stages that empathy operate, and this was discussed in an earlier paper. At the first stage, one's empathic experience of the other person starts from the emergence of that other person to the empathizer as an experience of the person we empathize with. And this immediate sensual encounter is what makes her observation similar to and also different from Lipps's theory. In a section, Transition to the Foreign Individual, Stein explains the foreign other that relates to me is represented to me as the, quote, physical body, unquote, in my sight. It, quote, occurs as a living body. Consciousness occurs as the soul of the unified individual, unquote. Sense is important to ignite empathy, as she argues, quote, this basic level of constitution has always been ignored so far, unquote, reminiscent of Lipps. However, it is important to note that the foreign body exists just there themselves, neither coming to me nor transmitting any information to me. and it is I who starts to move towards there, projecting my feeling into the other. This status is called in Steinstein zero point of orientation. I, as a person in the world, and this I is yet a sensing I in the first stage of empathy. And here, Stein challenges Lipsitz's lumping of sensation and contagion when he discusses the nature of empathy as an evident outer representation of my inner movement, analogous to perception. Instead, Stein thinks a sensation is a sentient, triggering element which does influence the contagion that works at a different level. They do not have to correspond. So she distinguishes how empathy occurs between two beings and how empathy constructs each being. If, for Lips, it is possible for two individuals to be connected entirely through empathy, and if it would be unified what they feel and think, for Stein, the hypothesis does not elucidate as to how empathy constructs us as a subjective individual. I might feel something for what the other person has experienced and that I have not experienced. And in this case, the oneness cannot be claimed merely on the ground of the content of the two beings' perception. Stein argues that sensual representation only denotes the way it occurs on the body. So although we are affected, it is not a complete empathy. The refusal of the postulation that my feeling can be the same as others, such as Stein's model of humanity, is multi-layered. This was also often discussed in the conference. So multi-layered and complex one, where the I in the world accumulates every contact and experience that comes in our life. As a thinker whose idea originated from Husserlian phenomenology, Stein takes the notion of empathy in a spatial sense. The space of empathy is part of my world that I open as a possibility to get connected with others, willingly to be shaped by empathy. However, the space exists through a constant negotiation of the boundaries of my world and for another's world, because their world is open to exactly the same possibility too. Stein's idea of one's relationship with others is thus dynamic and fluid. It may seem vulnerable, but it bears potential to embrace what the foreign living body means to me. Here, I quote one of her examples. When it suddenly appears before me, it faces me as an object. For instance, the sadness I read in others' face. But when I inquire into its implied tendencies, so when I try to bring the other's mood to clear givenness to myself, the experience is no longer an object for me, but has pulled me into. I'm now no longer turned towards the experience, but instead I'm turned towards the object of the experience. I'm at the subject of the original experience, at the subject place, and only after having fulfilled a clarification of the experience does it appear to me as an object. I'd like to highlight the instance of pulling me into in a passage because it is the immediacy that transports one to the next empathy stage, which Stein explains as, quote, the fulfilling explication. Before this psychic movement takes place, the phenomenon I see from the other presents itself to me as the givenness of foreign subject and their experiences. Aforementioned, it is just there, not coming to me. As essential empathy, the first stage, emerges, then cognition entails, through the pulling me into process, which is the start of a second stage, according to Stein. So now my understanding of the other's feeling is no longer given to me, but I actively engage myself into other, quote, turned towards the object, unquote, deriving the understanding from my making sense of what it would be like to be in such situation as seeing the other object or person. So this thinking process is solely based on my experience, and Stein's suggestion for how to envisage the phenomenon of empathy is based on her premise that empathy is a way of feeling oneself into the experience of other person. And at this point, we should remind one of Stein's two postulations, which is that there is no psychic or telepathic I who surpasses the extent of my experience and feel, thus no other's mind. With the intentional projection, The empathizer only desires to understand others' experience through the empathizer himself or herself experience. Therefore, in terms of content, strictly speaking, it is a self-bound process, I would argue. The argument that empathy is ultimately a self-bound process is what distinguishes her position from other theories. And this claim may sound cynical and maybe solipsistic. She does not celebrate empathy as a key to redemption of humanity. Rather, she stresses empathy is the feeling alongside the other in empathy, which is neither to be confused with feeling together in the sense of having a mutual experience of the same thing. It is also not to be confused with that which both Stein and her fellow scholar Schiller named sympathy, which is the empathizer's feeling of care for the empathy. Empathy is neither a matter of sharing the same feeling in the strict sense, nor is it necessarily a compassionate feeling for others. And since it is impossible for us to know something beyond our experience, my empathy for others can be both original and not original at the same time. Therefore, even if we feel strained, alien, and even precisely the opposite to the sight of others' distress or happiness, it can be a sign of empathy for Stein. To be exact, the first sign that we are at least affected and about to empathize can be seen as an intention to know others through my inner engagement. The individuals, as Stein calls psychophysical beings in her book, can be imperfect in the world, as their empathy is not always in accordance with the foreign person's feeling. Or most of all, if memory intervenes, what if I feel others' pain just because I had the pain before? How can I feel others' pain if I had not the same experience before? Is my pain the same as others' pain in my sight? These possible interventions might even make one repeat imperfect empathy over and over again. And these questions made Stein again distinguish empathy from other similar feelings such as memory, fantasy, and expectation. And unlike the three, empathy requires representation on the foreign body. She finds this answer from the act of seeing. And let me reiterate Stein's another example of empathy. I see a person in the crowd with my intentionality as I'm pulled in through my eyes into her or his internal world that I can associate. I could be someone with a countenance that reminds of my certain feeling in the past, but my eyes only see the surface of the person. I feel for the person, feeling his internal mind with my assumption. Since it is my assumption and the result could lead to satisfaction or not, since there is always the space of intersubjectivity in the empathized status, which is neither entirely mine nor his nor hers. So despite this discrepancy, it is still a way of responding to others. And it is my reading of Stein's empathy that the act of being openness and the registering my experience to others is important as it is. We do not have to crystallize the final answer for what empathy is. And thinking this way, one could even claim that Stein's idea resonates with Wilhelm Waringer, her contemporary art historian. What Waringer focuses on is the tendencies of artists in his time was a volition as a result of negative empathy or abstraction in his time. That signifies their response to the world anyway. Even though it is a non-representational and non-mimetic form, the abstraction for Waringer is another way of staying connected in the world by expressing their internal feeling, especially anxiety, empathized and stirred. Similarly, Stein's notion of intentionality can be viewed in alignment with Waringer's volition. If there is one thing that Stein's idea differs from Waringer, it is that Stein's empathy weighs more on personhood than aesthetics. And although I have included a section on Waringer in my thesis, due to the time limit, maybe I should stop here, introduce a little bit about what I want to point out in the case of the Gothic literature. So though Gothic literature was popular in the 18th century, the reception was not always positive. Literary criticism at the time in Britain encouraged novel to be a tool to form a civic society by featuring characters who deserved respect. So the mode of self-inviting was necessary, establishing a bond between text and writing subject. So the readers can be guided by the good novel, so to speak, who writes in what purpose and how was a prior concern. And for the commentators in the 18th century, Gothic fiction served in a direction exactly the opposite from what they wanted to encourage. The heroines, often the young and innocent orphan, lacks a sense of self, not to mention a sense of reality. For example, Anne Radcliffe's heroine, Emily St. Aubert, is highly susceptible to the mysterious sound and obscure figures every time, and she almost never overcomes such occasions because she always faints or screams when she feels the existence of the unknown around her. The setting is not only unrealistic, it was also often blamed to make the readers abandon their duty and lock themselves up in the room to devour the novels. And if a character can be translated as a writer's model of humanity, maybe it seemed that the Gothic writers hold almost no interest in building a moralistic, pro-social, enlightening human nature through their writing. Instead, they're irrational, tyrannical, supernatural, as far as it concerns the dark and old themes, occupies the setting of Radcliffe's every writing. And I've been writing about this 18th century notion of sublime that is arguably a prototype of 19th century notion of empathy in my thesis. But to cut the long discussion short, let me skip that part and just address Radcliffe's case in here. There are numerous scenes where Emily's horror is heightened when she encounters a figure that she believes to be a corpse, a ghost, or any kind of a supernatural object. After her father dies, Emily moves to a medieval castle in Italy to live with her aunt, who recently got married with an Italian count who is a villain in the novel. And she hears a lot of rumors and stories of the haunted castle as her servants tell her about the dead first wife of the count as follows. They do say that the signora has been seen several times since walking in the woods and about the castle in the night, blah, blah, blah. And this kind of scene recurs again and again. Emily is haunted, Emily faints, and then she discovers the mystery of the castle. So although she received bad criticism in her days, mainly by the male commentators who blamed her as a low-grade writer who stimulated a cheap thrill, as I address in the scene just above, the otherworldly experience in Radcliffe's literature definitely differs from her contemporaries. In the Gothic scholarship, we tend to position her in the category of terror Gothic. So it usually engages with a feeling of terror when we read Gothic fiction, and also the feeling that Emily has in the fiction is a form of terror rather than horror. So she does not scream, or she does not, you know, it's not like a horror film that we see. It's more like a very obscure description of whatever it is, and then she approximates the object and it builds up tension and thrill, and then it moves to another scene. It's always like that. So in an essay, Radcliffe argues that some feelings like terror can expand our sense of self. And this is where I want to engage Stein in the discussion of Radcliffe. So Radcliffe calls it terror and tries to generate it through her novel. She writes, quote, "But a terror of this nature, as it occupies and expands the mind and elevates to high expectation, is purely sublime and leads us by a kind of fascination to seek even the object from which we appear to shrink." And what I see here is the consecutive recurrence of the self attempting to be connected with the other or with the world, despite the threshold that entails a certain tension, terror, when we approximate to another being. And this is where I use Stein to fill in the gaps of my reading of Radcliffe's novel. Although Stein does not take many examples to demonstrate our idea of empathy, she appears to acknowledge that the other being, such as an object, stands just there. It doesn't do anything to me, and it is myself who is pulled into that beam, and we find the same case in Radke's novel. The object of terror in a castle, such as a strange tune in the abandoned fishing house or a mummy in the vault, they do not do anything to Emily. It is the character Emily's sentience that makes her approximate and retreat from the object. And according to Radke, this process of approximation and retreat kind of expands the realm of the self. And I say the relevance of Radke's claim in Stein's discussion on empathy. Although this supernatural occasion do not bear any realistic significance in the novel, Emily grows into a person who may not be desirable in the marriage market, but who is virtuous and knows how to mourn after her father's death. Radcliffe used the word fortitude to celebrate Emily's personality and maturity in the end. Just as Radcliffe rejects the notion of strong self-consciousness through the depiction of a Gothic heroine Emily, Stein also rejects the notion of I as a united entity. The critical question is addressed again, where she asserts that it is not possible to understand Einfühlung as reflexive sympathy, which was earlier argued by her fellow scholar Max Schiller in his conceptualization of Mitfühlung. On the two-part participation process in an empathetic movement, which Stein characterizes as a con-original or a con-primoriality, the no one and both one's feeling is not entirely his or her experience, nor my experience, and yet it is something that only I can feel in my feeling for someone else. And this is where the zero point of orientation empowers her theory. Unlike general notion of empathy today indicates putting...
Eugene, 1 minute.
Oh, yes. Okay. So I think I should conclude here. So I'll just skip the zero point of empathy part. And just to conclude, what I want to stress in Radke's novel is a mode of empathy, as Stein argues. It is almost like she's pulled in when she hears, sees anything that stimulates her sentience. And although such repetitive experience does neither make her intelligent nor virtuous as required for a woman at her time, she endures an event that could have broken her apart, which was her father's death. So there are scenes where Emily does not act as a desired woman in the marriage market. She is a bookworm, reads too much, and she does not mingle people in her circle. In a way, she does not live up to her aunt's expectation. But if I read her in Stein's frame, that does not matter. Because there is no notion of I as a united entity, we are always in conflict with our senses as a sign of the body, our language that attempts to rationalize what we just felt. Likewise, in Radke's novel, Emily first reacts by sense. She is haunted, she faints, but later she finds reason and when she wakes, but then the explained mystery is led to another mystery. She therefore continues to explore the castle and search for the secret of murder or whatever it is. She eventually finds out that most of the occasions that put her into horror was rather nothing. Sometimes it is no shadow. This is why the novel is nicknamed The Supernatural Explained. Since the supernatural does not contribute anything to a better reality, Radke's Gothic was considered nothing more than entertainment. But still, to conclude, I want to argue that Stein hints at the expressive dimension of the human nature when she describes empathy, and this expressive dimension can be demonstrated better when I read Radke's novel and also Wilhelm Waringer's book on the form of the Gothic and also abstraction, which I should stop here for further discussion. So I'll leave it to the questions later on. Thank you.
Thank you, Jean. Is anybody have any questions? I don't know. Okay, I make you a question. I don't. Okay, is it from the perspective of empathy, how do you think confinement has affected people by reducing physical contact with people so much? And if the literature can overcome this limitation, how do you think about?
Did you mean confinement?
Yes, confinement. Okay.
Oh, can you repeat the question again?
Yes. From the perspective of empathy, how do you think confinement has affected people? Affected by reducing physical contact so much, and if the literature can overcome this limitation, how do you think about this?
Okay, so by confinement, would you mean like the pandemic?
Yes, the pandemic. Yes,
the restricted access to others. Yes, because I've been thinking about the form of interaction with others, and I know that the sales of the novel during the pandemic was rising paradoxically. So I think people always want to be connected, and strangely, we always talk on a Zoom, but I don't think it's the same as reading experience, because reading, when we read a character, I see there are two experiences. So first, there is a character's experience, and there is our experience of the character. So I think reading experience is much more multi-layered than, I don't know, Zoom or other kind of virtual experience. And the reason why I'm focusing on the Gothic fiction is, although Gothic and empathy and staying, they seem very opposite and not relevant to each other, there is a sense of not reality, but I just forgot the word, but it makes sense as it is. So once we get into the world of the Gothic fiction, we understand the character, which can be the synonym of the other. Intersubjectivity can be, there is pictoriality, so the setting and the background has to be like a picture so that we can imagine and we can put ourselves into the world of the fiction. And it's not like the character or the event in the Gothic fiction drives us a cheap thrill. It's almost a volunteer movement from our side to the event in the Gothic. Or it doesn't have to be Gothic. It can be any other forms of art or novel, anything. So I guess I'm very interested in our inner movement when we see an object, or when we feel the other, when we see something that is beyond my extent of perception. Because although instantly we feel something negative, we still feel pleasure. So there is intensity and the rhythm. So the discrepancy between the rationality and the bodily movement. And this is what I value in my research about empathy.
Great, thank you. Thank you very much. Nobody makes a question, but thank you very much, Eugene.
Thank you.
For your great paper and presentation, and I'm going to introduce to Gardik. Okay, Gardik, are you there? ¿Estás por ahí, Gardik?
Hola, Paulina. ¿Qué tal? ¿Cómo estás?
I'm going to speak in Spanish. Yes, I. Entonces, Gardik, buenos días. Vamos a hablar ahora en español, para ya que tú hablas español y yo también, y la conferencia pues permite todos estos idiomas. Bien, de nuevo, bueno, Gardik estudió teología y también filosofía en la Pontificia Universidad Católica de Perú, y actualmente está haciendo el máster en educación y psicología. Y bien, hoy pues nos presentará su texto. Y si quieres comenzar, Gardik, por favor, diciéndonos el título. Yo no sé por qué aquí lo perdí. El título. Ah, ok. Espérame, es que tuve aquí un problema, pero... bien, su texto se titula Una aproximación a la empatía desde la tesis doctoral de Edith Stein y su implicancia en el autoconocimiento. Ok,
gracias. Gracias, Paulina. Bueno, así es, ¿no? O sea, mi interés por Edith Stein surge desde que estuve estudiando teología. Y bueno, desde ese entonces he tratado de aproximarme a ella. El hecho también de hacer una maestría en educación y en psicología es encaminándome un poco a poder encontrar o profundizar más en su pensamiento, que lo encuentro bastante apasionante, ¿no? Bueno, la idea es recopilar a algunas partes o algunos textos que nos ayuden a encontrar ¿qué es esto de la empatía? Que en este contexto pandémico también se ha hablado mucho, ¿no? Hay que tener empatía, hay que ser empáticos, hay que ponernos en los zapatos del otro, como comúnmente se habla, menos en Latinoamérica y creo que en todo el mundo. Sin embargo, esta expresión, aunque bastante común, no termina por definir qué es ese ponerse en, ¿no? Entonces se nos viene la interrogante, ¿es tal vez un contagiarse del ánimo del otro o es un sentimiento que prima más allá del entendimiento, es un entender? Bueno, esa es más o menos la interrogante, ¿no? Y cabe recordar que esta expresión empatía ha sido vista a lo largo del tiempo desde diferentes miradas temáticas y posee una vasta literatura que aborda la génesis y las diversas propuestas del planteamiento. Sin embargo, me uno a la opinión de muchísimos estudiosos, fenomenólogos, filósofos, que piensan que son los fenomenólogos los que, aportando el análisis experiencial de la empatía, cimientan una base ineludible para el entendimiento del otro y su reconocimiento como un ser físico, vivo, que se desarrolla en el mundo de la vida. Una de las fenomenólogas que presta especial interés, como todos sabemos, es Edith Stein, ¿no? De ahí que de la mano de esta autora pretendo exponer qué es ese acto empático. Además, en la profundización de este concepto, hay algo que me llamó peculiarmente la atención y es que ella bosqueja el tema del autoconocimiento dentro del tema de la empatía, puesto que en el develamiento del otro que se genera en la intersubjetividad se revelan características únicas del mí mismo propiamente o implícitamente, iniciando el camino del autoconocimiento. Bueno, sobre el término de la empatía, se sabe que el psicólogo Edward Titcher fue quien introdujo el término inglés empatía, posiblemente para traducir la noción de Lips de Einfühlung. Lips perteneció al círculo de Múnich, como sabemos, y será de quien Husserl escuchará hablar sobre la empatía. Lo demás creo que es historia conocida que intentaré abordar sucintamente, ¿no? Como es sabido, Husserl tuvo un especial interés en el tema de la empatía, le dedicó muchísimo tiempo, muchísimas obras creo que están insertas en el tema de la empatía. Sahavi comenta que no es posible dar un análisis exhaustivo de la teoría de la empatía de Husserl debido a su extensión. Además, considera que tal vez no exista una teoría coherente de parte de Husserl, puesto que éste persiguió diferentes direcciones, ¿no? En torno a Einstein, dice McIntyre, que cuando Husserl aceptó asignar a Einstein el estudio de la empatía, ya sabía que se trataba de uno de los temas centrales de la filosofía que requería de su atención. Al parecer, Husserl abordó en muchas ocasiones el tema de la empatía, pero no aclaraba en qué consistía, dice la misma Stein, y lo dice en el siguiente texto, ¿no? Durante una de sus clases, Husserl había dicho que no se podía aprender un mundo exterior objetivo, sino de una forma intersubjetiva, es decir, por una pluralidad de individuos que saben que se comunican unos a otros. Para ello, al tener una experiencia de los otros, era, por tanto, una condición previa. Husserl llamaba a esta experiencia Einfühlung, pero no aclaraba en qué consistía. Por lo tanto, sigue la autora, había que llenar ese vacío. Yo quería explorar lo que era el Einfühlung, esa capacidad de sentir lo que siente el otro desde el interior. Esto es interesantísimo y lo voy a desarrollar, bueno, si es que me da el tiempo, al final, cómo esta expresión va relacionada con el autoconocimiento, ¿no? Bueno, así Stein hace una profundización del estudio y el desarrollo de Husserl sobre la empatía. Consecuentemente, con su postura filosófica, Stein examina la empatía a través del método fenomenológico, puesto que su pretensión no era una descripción del tema de la empatía, sino encontrar qué es ese empatizar, ¿no? La esencia de esto, y en palabras de Stein diríamos, comprender el fenómeno en su pureza, la esencia pura, liberada de todos los accidentes de apariencia. Ahora bien, considero que para poder identificar la esencia del acto empático, Stein reconoce ciertas bases sobre las que lleva a cabo la investigación. Considero que en primer lugar Stein señala que aunque no se pudiera dudar de un yo empírico, aunque se pudiera dudar de ese yo empírico, lo que es indubitable es que yo como sujeto de vivencias no puedo dudar de esto, ¿no? Este de encontrarme mi yo en este vivenciar, eso es ineludible, dice ella, ¿no? Y en segundo lugar, la otra base es que reconoce que existe otros sujetos que también vivencian, ¿no? En las palabras de Stein dice, otros sujetos con sus vivencias, y que soy consciente de ese vivenciar, yo sé de su vivenciar. Esta última afirmación es el punto de interés de Stein para el desarrollo del acto empático, puesto que, dice Stein, el fenómeno de la vida psíquica ajena está ahí y es indubitable, y queremos considerarlo ahora más de cerca. De allí se desprenden dos cuestiones que serán los objetos de su trabajo doctoral, ¿no? Como se sabe, ver cuál es la esencia del acto empático y luego cómo esta empatía ayuda o genera una construcción del individuo, ¿no? Para reconocerlo como individuo psicofísico, la personalidad, es decir, el tratamiento de la empatía como problema de constitución. Para desarrollar la esencia de la empatía, Stein tendrá que especificar qué tipo de acto es la empatía. Y a modo de introducción, Stein en su trabajo doctoral realiza una comparación con otros actos para que en una dinámica apofática, se podría decir, se pueda intuir o develar la naturaleza de la empatía. Entre los actos que analiza, como sabemos, está la percepción externa, el recuerdo, la espera, la fantasía y, bueno, la empatía misma, ¿no? Sobre la percepción externa, Stein toma de Husserl la distinción entre presentación, Gegenwärtigung, y representación, Vergegenwärtigung, en el que el primer término es la presentación. La presentación se identifica con la percepción externa, donde el objeto se da directamente y se experimenta, como dice ella, allí en la carne. Y otras formas de representación donde el objeto no se presenta con la misma firmeza o determinación. En este sentido, los actos del recuerdo, la espera, la fantasía y la misma empatía estarán en esta representación. Aunque la empatía no es una percepción externa, tiene algo en común con ella, dice Stein. Stein ejemplifica la empatía a través del dolor y dice que al ver a un amigo que ha perdido a su hermano, él nota el dolor, pero no capta el dolor en sentido físico, es decir, por gestos, y el aspecto de su amigo sumido en dolor. De allí que no es una percepción externa. Lo que capta es el dolor mismo que se manifiesta en los gestos de dolor. Por tanto, existe una cuasi percepción que es un tipo específico de acto de experiencia. Esta idea se encamina a la relación simbólica planteada por Sleep, con la que Stein no está de acuerdo. Ella piensa que la relación con el otro no solo se expresa en semblantes y gestos. Yo puedo ver un semblante triste, palidez, etcétera, gestos, percepción externa, pero la empatía es descubrir qué es lo que está detrás de estos gestos. Si bien existe una relación por la que yo me conecto con el individuo, es cierto que capto los gestos expresados en su ser físico, pero no me quedo en el gesto físico. Por la empatía, puedo ir más allá y cuasi percibir el dolor. Einstein señala que aunque la empatía no es una percepción externa, no quiere decir que no posea un carácter originario, sin embargo tampoco lo contradice. Conviene aquí preguntarnos o recordar qué entendemos por originariedad. El término originariedad que toma Einstein es una profundización de lo expuesto por su maestro Husserl, quien expone el sentido del término en Ideas 1. El término originariedad está relacionado con el modo de darse de los objetos, esa daridad, ¿no? Por tanto, tiene un papel central en el desarrollo de la empatía. En su texto de contribuciones, Einstein explica que como originario y no originario, Husserl quiso explicar la forma en que se nos da las experiencias, equiparándolas a impresiones e ideas. Einstein señala que las experiencias originarias son aquellas experiencias que se prestan con mayor vivacidad, vitalidad, dinamismo, viveza, animación, es decir, que se nos dan como una impresión fuerte. Mientras que las no originarias son aquellas representaciones que tienen menos impacto, más débiles, opacadas cuando me conecto con ellas, ¿no? Y ella pone un ejemplo, ¿no? Ella dice, bueno, esa originalidad vendría a ser el dolor de muelas y lo no originario sería el recuerdo de mi dolor de muelas. Nótese que en torno a los actos del recuerdo, la fantasía, estos están catalogados también como actos no originarios en cuanto a su contenido, ya que no existen como originarios, sino como habiendo sido alguna vez en el caso del recuerdo o fantaseando. Sin embargo, son originarios en cuanto al yo, el yo que los recuerda o los fantasea, ¿no? Así pues, el recuerdo de una alegría, el recuerdo mismo es originario, dado que se da en la vivencia del recordar. Ahora, la alegría recordada no es originaria, porque no se da aquí y ahora. Es más, ya no existe. Su existencia se remite a un acto no originario de mi recordar. Entonces, cuando yo recuerdo, lo original en este recordar soy yo, dado que no puedo dudar de mi yo y su vivenciar. Y este vivenciar concretamente es el recordar, es la experiencia más fuerte, vital que tengo. Ahora, el recuerdo es algo que develo en la memoria, ya no posee espacio, temporalidad y tiempo fuera de mí. En ese sentido, es no originario para mí. En este mismo sentido, se da también la fantasía. Así también la empatía es un acto originario como vivencia presente, pero no originario según su contenido, ya que está en el otro. Esta se da porque el individuo psicofísico, por su naturaleza viviente, es decir, desarrollándose y aquí y ahora, tiene combinaciones, dice Einstein, bastante complejas, en las que se desarrollan las experiencias originarias y no originarias. En este punto nos preguntamos qué es lo que hace diferente a la empatía del recuerdo, la espera y la fantasía. Para aclarar este punto, tal vez sea pertinente considerar la idea de participación interior, señalada tanto por Lipps como por Scheler, a quien Einstein confronta en sus obras sobre la empatía. Por un lado, Lipps considera que la empatía como es, considera la empatía como esta participación interior, una presentificación a modo de recuerdo o fantasía. El problema de esto está en que, como dice Einstein, cuando vivencio un sentimiento como de otro, lo tengo dado por un lado como originario, como propio ahora, pero por otro lado como no originario, que empatizo como originario ajeno. Y precisamente la no originalidad de la vivencia empatizada me introduce a desmentir el título de una percepción interna, puesto que si bien existe un tipo de percepción interna en la que la empatía es parte de la progresión gradual en la que se da esta, la misma empatía, como lo veremos más adelante, en este sentido, Einstein considera que Lipps confunde el sujeto que se da para la empatía en la experiencia empatizante y la experiencia misma. Esta confusión lleva a Lipps a interpretar la empatía como una imitación del otro. en Lips no hay ninguna distinción, dice Stein, entre el yo propio y el ajeno. En la confrontación con Scheler, también Stein rechaza la idea de la experiencia interna, ya que este autor plantea que podemos experimentar no solo las propias experiencias, sino también las del otro, a través de una especie de percepción interna o intuición. Bueno, personalmente no me parece aquí que Scheler esté realizando una fusión. Sin embargo, bajo la mirada fenomenológica de Stein, reconoce que Scheler minimiza la diferencia esencial entre la autoexperiencia y la otra experiencia, lo que podría llevar a una confusión de fusión, ¿no? O sea, confundirlo como una fusión. En esto de identificar lo propio de la empatía en comparación con los otros, se había señalado un progreso gradual de la empatía, y es así. Stein señala los diferentes niveles que existe al empatizar. Por ejemplo, cuando nos encontramos o nos enfrentamos a la euforia o la tristeza de la cara del otro, aparece ante mí la aparición de la vivencia, dice ella, ¿no? Ahí yo podría tener una comprensión vaga y algo vacía de la experiencia del otro. Pero luego paso a otro nivel, no me quedo en el gesto, en lo físicamente significable, y trato de entenderlo mejor. Trato de explicar su estado de ánimo, su carácter de explicación plenaria, así lo señala ella. Ahí cuando ya trato de entenderlo, hay una explicación plenaria. Esto me hace entrar en un plano experiencial que deja atrás la postura de ver a otro como, para poder ver a otro solamente como un ente físico, ¿no? Ya entro más allá, entro a objetivar qué es eso que está más allá de lo físico. Stein ofrece un ejemplo a través de la experiencia de la alegría, pero considero pertinente para su mejor aclaración la adaptación del ejemplo que propone Sahavi cuando dice: considere una situación en la que se encuentre un niño llorando. La empatía le permitirá discernir la angustia del niño incluso antes de saber que el niño está molesto. Pero si tu empatía es más profunda, buscará entender qué es lo que le ha molestado al niño. Y finalmente, habiendo captado el objeto de la emoción, volverás a girar hacia el niño, pero esta vez con una mejor o más plena comprensión de su angustia. Incluso cuando sigo la atracción intencional de la angustia del niño y me pongo en contra, digamos, de la madre ausente, la angustia me es dada de manera bastante peculiar. No se siente como mi propia angustia, ni como una angustia recordada, y mucho menos como una angustia imaginada. No, lo que se da es la angustia del otro. Esto es muy importante en el tema de la empatía. De ahí que Stein rechace también la teoría de la asociación para explicar la empatía, ya que la idea de asociar es interpretar el gesto desde mi experiencia personal haciendo lo propio. Y esta no es la idea de la empatía, ya que la empatía, dice Stein primero, se da ante nosotros como un objeto, no está motivada por vivencias propias precedentes, y tercero, no encuentra su expresión en un gesto. En esta línea también Stein rechaza el equiparar el desarrollo empático con la inferencia por analogía. Aquí, dice Stein, la experiencia de la conciencia ajena es totalmente ignorada porque se supone la aprehensión de otro como yo. Así pues, Stein señalará que el acto empático es un acto sui generis, y eso es, lo dijo es ya hace mucho tiempo, y creo que es importante resaltarlo, ¿no? Es sui generis porque principalmente porque la experiencia empatizante se encuentra en el otro y no en uno mismo, ¿no? O sea, ese, como habíamos dicho al inicio, ponerse en los zapatos de él, no es experimentar mis sentimientos o querer poner mis sentimientos en los sentimientos de otro, ¿no? Entonces, es sui generis principalmente porque La experiencia empatizante se encuentra en otro y no en uno mismo, y además posee características de originario y no originario. Para Stein, la empatía indudablemente no es una cuestión de atribuir abstractamente un cierto estado mental, lo que estaba diciendo a otro. O sea, no atribuyo mi estado mental a otro, porque reconoce al otro y lo valora. Atribuir mis propios estados mentales sería quitarle el valor de cómo es el otro y sus estados mentales, y respeta sus diferencias. Por eso es que busca con diligencia buscar cómo encuentro qué es el otro y cómo se muestra, cuál es su contexto y su vivencia, para aprender aquello que está dando que se está dando a través, tal vez, de la intuición, ¿no? La otra cuestión a la que atiende Stein en el problema de la empatía es cómo se constituyen en la conciencia las objetividades de las que habla las teorías usuales de la empatía, a saber, el individuo psicofísico, personalidad y semejantes. Considero que cuando Stein profundiza en la constitución del individuo psicofísico, aborda implícitamente, como devenido, el tema del autoconocimiento. Aunque muchos autores consideran en el trayecto de la profundización del tema de la constitución que se revelan temas como la individualidad, la afectividad, los valores, la religión, la metafísica, también, según mi parecer, existen algunos aspectos importantes en el tema de autoconocimiento. Por tanto, mi propósito será intentar señalar algunos rasgos del autoconocimiento en el proceso de constitución y el papel de la empatía en este conocimiento de sí mismo. Los primeros esbozos de...
Tienes como 5 minutos para no extendernos.
Ok, está bien. Entonces, bueno, los primeros esbozos del autoconocimiento los encuentro cuando Edith desarrolla el tema del yo puro, en el que el yo empatizante se reconoce como yo individual. Este reconocimiento se da en el proceso empático. Es ahí en el que yo... el que el yo reconoce una cualidad de mismidad que se fundamenta en todo aquello que es mío y no otro. Este reconocimiento, dice Stein, se da cuando conozco la otroriedad, a lo que ella denomina alteridad. Es decir, reconozco otro yo en el tú. Y en este reconocer al otro, reconozco que yo soy el que conoce mi mismidad, mi individualidad, lo que me hace a mí mismo y no otro. Bueno, nos podríamos preguntar, o me pregunto en este punto, que si es solamente en la conciencia como yo puedo reconocer reconocer al otro como realmente otro. Y bueno, considero para esto la respuesta que ofrece Stein cuando dice que reconozco al otro como otro en el contenido vivencial peculiar, que en síntesis vendría a ser que yo y otro, si bien es cierto, cada uno en el mundo de la vida nos encontramos en un vivenciar, ¿no? Entonces, ese vivenciar y la forma en que él ha captado las vivencias lo hace peculiarmente diferente. Y yo también, mi yo y mi vivenciar me hace peculiarmente diferente. Por eso dice ella el contenido vivencial. Esto lo dice porque aún no se ha convertido, no conoce el concepto del alma como aquello que te da una personalidad o particularidad, porque me estoy restringiendo el tema de su doctorado de la empatía, pero esto se desarrollará muchísimo más en sus escritos de 1922, en el que ya inserta o entiende mejor el tema del alma como aquello que nos da la individualidad y la personalidad, ¿no? Bueno, el tema del autoconocimiento lo vuelve a retomar, y bueno, para no extenderme ya mucho, solamente digo que en la dinámica empática que empleo en el otro, puede ser como una herramienta para mí mismo. Más allá de esto, la exposición esteniana muestra que es a través de mi experiencia de los demás que puedo precisamente llegar a alcanzar una nueva experiencia de mí mismo. Esto lo desarrolla de una forma bastante interesante, pero bueno, ¿por qué señalo el tema del autoconocimiento? porque creo que estas son algunas líneas en las que se pueden desenvolver una serie de interrogantes y propuestas, pero principalmente en las que se reconoce cómo es que el tema del autoconocimiento empieza a asomarse en la inquietud filosófica y personal de Wittgenstein, hasta llegar a convertirse en el camino por el cual puede alcanzar ella la plenitud de vida, ¿no? Stein, con una fineza fenomenológica, empieza a descubrir el llamado de Dios a su verdadera vocación. Antes habíamos dicho que ella decía, yo quería conocer qué es esa empatía, ¿no? ¿Qué es ese conocer? Porque como digo, el llamado de Dios a su verdadera vocación, que es conocerse a sí mismo. En el fondo, cuando Stein quiere conocer al otro, también intuyo que quiere encontrar el conocerse a sí mismo, ¿no? Puesto que el conocimiento propio auténtico desemboca en el conocimiento de Dios. Este camino bosquejado en la empatía culminará en el reconocimiento de que solo de la mano de Dios es posible llegar a la interioridad de nuestras vidas, donde reconociendo la presencia divina encontramos la plenitud de la vocación humana. De ahí que me parece, si no entendí mal la exposición anterior, la empatía no termina de poder brindarnos todas las herramientas de conocimiento del otro y autoconocimiento. Necesitamos, como lo explicará en sus escritos de ser finito y ser eterno, esa mirada divina de Dios para llegar a esa vocación de conocerme a mí mismo, para ahí conocer también, para poder llegar a conocer a Dios con una perspectiva un poco agustiniana, de la que también Stein va a beber más adelante. Bueno, muchas gracias, Paulina. Muchas gracias, gracias por la escucha a todos.
Gracias. No sé si alguien tenga una pregunta. Podemos abrir su micrófono o la puede poner en el chat. ¿Alguien tiene alguna pregunta? Yo te quería preguntar algo. Bueno, Adriana, a ver. Adriana.
Hola, hola, sí. Buenos días.
Buenos días.
Mi pregunta sería si en algún momento en el desarrollo de los trabajos de Edith Stein se llega a indagar o ampliar el peso que tiene la intersubjetividad y la interrelación como terreno intersubjetivo, justamente el terreno relacional en donde confluyen las dos, el yo-tú, y se construye o se co-construye justamente la empatía y la posibilidad de saberse en ese autoconocimiento, pero saberse diferenciado de un otro. No sé si fui clara o me pudiera responder.
Sí, lo que pasa es que en la empatía misma ya ella está dando como el tip para reconocer que diferenciar, mejor dicho, y esa es la crítica que le hace a Lips, que cuando yo entro en empatía, la idea es que reconozco un otro, no es que haga una proyección de mí mismo en el otro. Entonces, desde ahí, ya ella empieza a marcar, digamos, el límite para que uno pueda entender qué es ese conocer realmente al otro y no solamente hacer como una proyección. Por eso es que yo decía en la exposición, es una postura interesante de Stein, porque al entrar o al tratar de explicar la empatía como ese reconocimiento del otro, es también reconocer su valor como persona, porque estoy reconociendo que no puedo, así como a la ligera, hacer una proyección o hacer decir, bueno, seguro que él le está doliendo porque a mí me dolía alguna vez. Hay en esas etapas que yo decía de la empatía, ese afán por querer entender realmente qué es el otro, ¿no? Qué es lo que esconde, como dice ella, detrás de ese gesto. Y eso es sumamente, creo, valioso en el tema de la empatía, porque también es un llamado a todos los que bueno, a todos los que profundizamos en ella, a tener un esfuerzo en el conocimiento del otro, que no solamente puedo ser como atribuir cosas o hacer un, o tener una relación superficial con el otro, sino que si yo me relaciono con el otro, debe haber esa dinámica en la que yo también me esfuerce por poderlo entender más. Y ya está en nuestra estructura. De hecho, ya tenemos como una estructura la capacidad de entendernos. Por ejemplo, el lenguaje es una de ellos, el hecho de ser seres humanos, el hecho de poder comunicarnos ya hace o da unos parámetros en los que nosotros nos podemos comunicar, sí, es cierto, pero existe también además aquello que ella dice, ya no lo puede poner por el tiempo, la reflexión, que si bien es cierto, se aplica en uno mismo cuando uno se conoce, pero también es dada o es posible cuando yo me entro en intersubjetividad con el otro. Ahora, se inicia la empatía, pero también está en los temas de las atribuciones psicológicas, las contribuciones psicológicas, y bueno, y más adelante existen, ya, sigue desarrollando ya, el tema de la empatía.
Ya estamos un poco sobre tiempo, ya nos pasamos. Okay. Yo solo respondiendo un poco a la pregunta, quería precisar que es justamente este punto de que esta acusación egológica a Husserl, que de alguna manera también se le puede hacer a Edith Stein, es que justamente la empatía no es moverme hacia el otro, desplazando, o sea, yo no puedo suplir al otro, y esto de la experiencia originaria es sumamente importante, porque es lo que te permite esta distinción que es fundante en la empatía para Edith Stein. O sea, yo me sé origen de mis acciones, ¿no? Y esto, yo sé que el otro, cuando el otro ríe, cuando el otro llora, él es origen de sus acciones y yo no soy el que origina ese acto, ¿no? Entonces, esta distinción es sumamente importante para no confundir la empatía con simpatía, bueno, y toda efectivamente la discusión con Lips y con otros, ¿no? Bien, pues ya estamos sobre tiempo. Les agradezco mucho su participación a Rick, a Eugene, que espero que sigan por aquí. Bueno, sí. A Eugene ya no la veo. Bueno, tampoco a Rick. En fin. Ah, no, Rick sí. Bien, entonces les agradezco a los tres. I'm going to speak in English. I thank the three young participants for their presentation. I think that for the members of IASPES and for the future of studies on the side of Edith Stein, the presence of young people is extremely important. We encourage you to continue studying the side of Edith Stein, as I am sure that their efforts will bear many fruits in people's lives and in the academic world. Bien, pues les agradezco mucho a los tres por esta participación. Pienso que es muy importante que las personas jóvenes estudien a Edith Stein para el futuro el desarrollo de los estudios de Edith Stein, también para los miembros de IASPES. Es importante su participación. Les agradezco y los animo a seguir en este esfuerzo por estudiarla, que seguramente dará muchos frutos en la vida de las personas y en el mundo académico. Ok, pues bien, damos por terminada esta sesión. Después tenemos una, no sé si va a ser en esta sala, pero bueno, creo que tenemos que salir y volver a entrar. O no sé qué nos digan los organizadores, José Miguel. ¿No está por acá José Miguel? Bien, entonces estamos por concluir esta mesa. Les agradezco mucho y va a haber un pequeño receso para después entrar a la reunión de los miembros de IASPES. Buenos días, buenas noches y Gracias.